Dolores, how are you?
I'm pretty good, thanks. How are you?
I'm blessed. No complaints.
Okay, good.
No complaints.
Yes,
Yeah.
yes, yes.
So I am so excited to be sharing some time with you. I think this is probably the first time you and I have had a moment to talk and speak
Right.
as artists, because we're
It's true.
already in motion, right? We first met at the South Dallas Cultural Center.
Correct.
I first met you, right?
Yes.
And I think, well, not I think, I know you were the
Yeah.
resident company of the center at the time.
Yes.
And
Yes.
still, you still are.
Correct.
Okay. Tell me a little bit about the company for those of us who are unfamiliar.
Well, we've been around for 25 years. It was started by Andre George, and he died a year after. So I was here and I said, well, I'll just go ahead and do it since I'd come from New York to Dallas. And there was a company, so I said, I'll do it. And I've been doing it ever since. And most of the time, we've been at the South Dallas Cultural Center. Yeah.
Okay. So
Yeah.
that's where you have been able to make and create the magic, right?
Yes. Well, a few years ago, I did something called 20 M&M. Part of it was madness and part of it was magic. So M&M, because you kind of have to be a little mad.
Yes, you're right. You're right.
But
They kind of work together.
yes.
Well, I've known your company to do some really beautiful works, and I think one of the things that stands out for me as an audience member watching your company, I'm reminded when we look at modern dance and Black modern dance, right? I'm reminded of the realness and authenticness of who we are as Black people inside of movement. There's a sincerity,
Yes.
there's a story, there's a narrative. And I think when I watch your work, I feel those things. I'm reminded to breathe. Your choreography really, executes breath and inside of lengthening, right? But also your company has been known to present works of renowned choreographers that have been trailblazers in Black dance. One to mention is the Ilio Kamari.
Correct. Correct.
So tell me a little bit about, before we talk about the work, let's talk about, because I think it's so important for audience to understand your placement personally as an artist and communication and relationship with Mr. Pomari. So kind of tell us how you became exposed to who this man is or was.
Right. Okay, well, it was 1977. I was looking at my paperwork, my notes, and it said 1977 for several years. In 1977, Charlie said 1997, whatever year, 77. Yeah, Charles Green, Eugene Grant III, who was dancing with Elio Pomare Dance Company, said, I probably ran into him at an audition or something. And he said, oh, you should come and work with Elio. He will strip the veneer from your dancing. And I said, okay, sure. And I went.
Okay. I'm sorry. I got to ask you about this phrase you just said. Strip the veneer from your hand. What is veneer?
Veneer is an outside coating that makes it acceptable. Let's just put it that way. When we as dancers go to class, we are trained to behave in a certain way, to carry ourselves in a certain way. But aside from the reality, there's a coating that makes it smooth and palatable, like medicine, some of it is bitter, then they put a coating on it to make it easier to swallow. And that's a veneer. I believe Charlie was talking about. That's what I've discovered LU did for us. Yeah.
So it's the veneer, to make sure that I'm clear. The veneer is the dancer understanding their studies and their trainings and how we should carry ourselves accordingly. But as we are working as artists, learning works, how to hold on to that, but strip that layer that shows kind of like,
it's actually to strip the falseness.
The falseness. Okay, the falseness. I couldn't remember the word.
Yeah.
To get in order to get to what the work is, in order
right.
to
correct what
the choreographer is intending mm-hmm. for us to authentically get there. Yeah.
Right. Okay. Yes.
So Mr. Pomari
did that, you know. It was not a problem for me. Mm-hmm. It was not. I just did what was asked, and I was in the group for the most part.
Okay.
And
how many company members were there doing it?
Oh, I know you had to ask. Let's say 8.
Okay.
It's as opposed to 50, as opposed to 2, it was about 8 or 10, you know.
And was there a first company, second company, or apprentice company, or was it just one group?
Just one group. Yeah. LU had worked with different people at different times. And so they had an affiliation with him. But this particular group just had about 8 or 10 people.
And yes. When you entered the company, how old were you when you entered the company?
Oh, I was 23. Wow.
You were
young. I was a child. You were
23, you know, that is a time right there where nothing really matters and you're not too
right.
afraid of anything.
You know Charlie said, come on down. And I said, okay. You right. know, the world just, was just there.
Mm. Right, right. So let's talk about your experience as a dancer working with Mr. Pomari.
Well, most of the times we would just get corrections, and I would try to, well, I must say one thing about myself is I try to yield to the choreographer's point of view.
Okay.
That was my thing, even though I didn't realize it was my thing. But I remember a different choreographer with a different body type and different aesthetic, if you will. And I felt I wanted to inhabit that. So while I had the surface classroom look, part of me also wanted to be an instrument for the choreographer. And I think that's what meshed with Elio's aesthetic, you know, that I wanted to be there. So it was not really a problem.
Mm-hmm.
But I did know, I went back and looked at it later. About a year later, he made something on me, mm-hmm. which was, as I look back, kind of extraordinary, because mm-hmm. he was already known as kind of a rebel.
Yes.
Something you want to stay away from, because he was an activist, you know, and he brought up realities that people didn't want to face.
That was the time that this idea of Black arts movement, mm-hmm. like that moment kind of flourished because of artists that was not afraid to say, this is how we are living in American culture. This is what my family goes through. That is my family member. So sharing those very vulnerable experiences, because you know, one thing about our culture, some of us are very private, right?
Mm-hmm.
And we don't talk about people in the family that's maybe on, you know, drugs or maybe, you know, addicted. Mm-hmm. We don't do that. You know, grandmama say, no, we don't talk about that.
Right.
But he put it out there.
Right. He put it out there in your face. If I had to say anything about Elio, once he hit the stage, he was on.
Mm.
And he would put it out there. He would quote, air dirty laundry, unquote. You know?
Tell the truth.
That was his thing, yeah. And it affected, it involved a lot of things we go through in life.
I just had a thought in between that. Do you think that by him putting those type of works out was for people to understand Blackness, or for people to be aware that these situations are happening and something must change?
He was labeled angry and a rebel because he was just saying what's real. I think people who lived in these circumstances already knew that, But in addition to the pride, there is abuse, there is addiction, and so on. And right. Elio put them out. Now, Elio had the company before me, before I started working with him.
Right.
And that's when he was really in the midst of the cauldron, the boiling that was happening in the late 60s. Mm-hmm. And he was already, because his stuff was so raw and in your face, let's say the establishment stood back from him, took a step away. He didn't get the same kind of funding that people who were able to smooth things out a little bit were able to.
Right.
Also, at that time, one Black company was enough. And he was saying stuff that people don't want to hear, so forget him,
So it's almost like sometimes our art is compromised by others' acceptance.
Exactly. Exactly.
And the reality of it is, racism during that time was at a very interesting place, because the Black voices hit this military place where enough was enough. Mm-hmm. And we're going to tell our stories and our narratives through our art. We're not gonna fight, we're not gonna do anything. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
That was a moment during that time where he definitely expressed, along with, and you can tell me, Pearl Primus.
Mm-hmm.
Pearl Primus is one of those artists who did works that was in your face. This is what it is.
Exactly.
Right. And she didn't get the funding, proper funding.
Herself. Exactly. Now, one or two people, and sometimes it takes us one or two people, not the masses, they felt that she was important enough to fund her to go to Africa. Because she had done a lot of research there. About the continent and the different cultures, but she hadn't gone there. And so somebody took it upon themselves to give her the funding to go there. But in terms of a large public following, it's just not the same. It's not popular. It's just not popular. For Black people and for white people, they want to keep the laundry in the corner.
Right.
When they go to the theater, they don't want to deal with certain realities.
Right.
But
because they don't want to make their audience members, who are patrons, who,
exactly.
They don't want to make them fatigue, So we suppress our art to some degree.
Exactly.
I've seen some amazing works over the past 20 years. I'm 45. Mm-hmm. Most of my life, I've seen some amazing works. But very seldom do you see a work like Elio Kamari, because, it's almost like, hey, there's a line, right?
Mm-hmm.
You want this? Well, you might have to just chisel down your anger, your narrative, your story, your, So he
The thing about Elio did not consider himself angry.
Right.
He just said, that's what's real. That is what is real. I'm putting it on the stage.
as though too long love it too long
Now, we wanted to do something in this spring, celebrating our 25 years.
I was going to ask you about that.
One of the things on the program had to deal with, it was by Elia Pomare, and it dealt with abuse. And, well, let me go back a little bit. He made a piece, and I tried to figure out what year this was, but I could not figure out what year exactly. But let's say in the 60s, in the latter part of the 60s, he made a dance called Blues for the Jungle.
Mm-hmm.
And a couple of the sections, well, 3 seconds in particular about Blues for the Jungle are Junkie. And you know about Junkie.
You know, yes.
That is a tour de force. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I remember seeing it at a very young age, and I was blown by the fact that somebody was acting, not really acting, mm-hmm. but they were portraying somebody.
Carrying you there.
Right. I'm like, mm-hmm. how is this? Is that dance? You know, when you're young, you don't know if that's dance or not, because when you're young, you're trained to think that the technique you're learning is the dance. Mm-hmm. But mm-hmm. he was like, you know,
mm-hmm.
addicted.
Right, exactly. He took that little coating that made it, oh, that frame, he took the frame off, and there it was.
Yes, he did.
No frame, no frame. So part of Blues for the Jungle was Junkie.
Mm-hmm.
Another solo I actually did later, in my later time with Elio, because not the solo he made for me, but the solo was called Night Spell. It's about a guy in prison. You know, many people don't go to the theater to see a guy in prison.
Right.
You know, because we live it, but Elio felt that it needed to be on stage.
Mm-hmm.
The jungle being the place that's you're struggle in.
Right.
So Blues for the Jungle, as perceived by other people, looking at the community as a jungle, them, and being in it, it's a struggle. Everything is dangerous, you know.
Right.
So jungle, yeah.
And also jungle, we can kind of, you know, expand that idea. You know, blues in the jungle at the time was America, because our problems were, one of the issues was like really, you know, self-identification inside of diversity, right? Mm-hmm. Black people, white people, Asian people, but there was a target. There was actually a target of people during his time mm-hmm. that was being mistreated or mm-hmm. Mishandled. Or so the jungle could have been America, but you can't say that.
It's kind of distressing because a lot of the problems that were in existence we didn't know about, but at the same time, we knew there was a dangerous place and we didn't know what other places gave. I read an interesting article about murder of a Black man.
Mm-hmm.
And it said, you know, that particular society said it was so nice and all that, but then they killed this guy. And the reason he was killed is because they assumed because he was Black. This is before they called things hate crimes per se.
Hmm.
But anyway.
And look how interesting this energy is still channeling.
Exactly.
Where we are right now.
Well, okay, let me go to the third part.
Okay.
The third part that I wanted to present was domestic abuse. And it had to do with when I take the bus from where I live, the second bus, I take 2 buses to get to the cultural center.
Okay.
But the second bus goes along a strip where you can see what you can almost imagine. You can almost smell what's going on behind the proceedings. In the proceedings, you can tell what's going on. And I felt that, you know, we need, it's called view from a tenement window. View from a tenement window. So it's like somebody walking by and seeing what's happening. And it really connects to Dallas because I heard a call that said, hey, he's trying to kill me, blah, 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 blah. And they didn't respond in a timely manner and it was too late.
Right.
And this dance relates to that kind of subject matter. So it's still going on.
So Blues from a, what is it?
Blues for the Jungle.
Blues for the Jungle. But the third piece that you mentioned that
View from a Tenement Window.
View from a Tenement Window. So correct. You express how you catch two buses, right? To get your home to the Culture Center. I remember when I was in middle school riding the bus and I would sit by the window purposely, right? I knew that I was going to see like so many like shots and frames and movie stills and people doing different things and until I got to my destination. So your ride, I'm just curious, like your ride from your home to the Culture Center, that piece kind of resonates that, you know, the things that we see when you leave from North Dallas, then you enter South Dallas, a different type of culture.
Exactly. You know, in my travels, it's like changing worlds. I like to stand back. That's just me. And where I've lived has always been away from the maddening crowd. But I felt a commitment to the Culture Center and they gave me space. So, you know, there was a connection right there. So I would go there, and on the way, like in the second part of the trip, you know, we'd go from home to downtown, from downtown to South Dallas Cultural Center. You could see a gas station, and you know that was just not a gas station. It was not about pumping gas. You know, I knew something else was going on.
It is always multiple things going on at the gas
station. And I could see people on that strip of the bus route getting onto the bus, and I know they were under the influence of some chemical or people's perception or their domestic situation or whatever. You know, you go,
ooh, that's ooh, the jungle. That's the jungle.
So I wanted to do that because he died, what, 10 years, a dozen years ago. So he's now creating, but at the time he was creative, he was creating, he was doing stuff that continues to be relevant.
Yes, that is still is relevant right this second.
You know?
Right.
So I said, you know, I remember that dance, and I didn't do it, but I remember being affected by it in a certain way.
Right, and that's how you know when artists that has left an impact in their work that is still relevant to this day, that's how you know they have an anointing. That dance, their art, their music, their monologue, they were given that for a reason. Because of the legacy that they leave now behind, and the work is still substance-wise, it is relevant because we still live in it. We live in the jungle, right? Now, when we were in a pandemic, all of us was looking through looking through the window, the mirror,
right? The tenement window.
We were looking through quarantine. We were looking through the tenement window, honey. So like that in itself is works that I feel as an educator, because we're both educators. That young people of all colors, if you study in dance, you need to study every history of the dance. Need to know people like Ilio Pomare. They need to know his work. They need to hear these conversations with people that have trained and danced and had works created on them.
Well, you know, it's very interesting in a way, because kids these days, and you know, that's one of those expressions. Kids these days, they get in their mama's car, the dad's car, granny's car, who's ever, they ride, and they're like, wear the earbuds and tune life out. They have no idea that people existed before them. They thought that I feel like dancing, so they dance, but they need to know whose shoulders they're standing on. Who said what before you even knew that it needed to be said?
Ashe.
Ashe.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. That's the part of dance education that we're losing.
Right, right.
We're wondering why our children are suffering with depression at, you know, 13, mm-hmm. 14, 15 years old.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of remedies that we have. Like we have some ancient medicines as mm-hmm. far as movement that we can mm-hmm. use. And mm-hmm. know to be told, mm-hmm. this is why you are great, mm-hmm. because of these people. Mm-hmm. And these ancestors, mm-hmm. you know, and that makes you feel like you're standing on something, on a foundation. Like
you right, have- right. You know, I watch a show on TV. Well, you know, I don't sit around watching TV or reading papers all day, but anyway,
right.
That's to say, I watch a show on TV that said, it's about finding your roots. Mm-hmm. And it's very interesting. A lot of people who've been profiled, you know, two or three people every time, they will say, I had no idea. These are grown people who had no idea and wanted to know, because there were people who made sacrifices before, made incredible decisions, life decisions before, mm-hmm. that affected their existence. Right. The reason they exist now is because what their parents and parents and parents, you know, what their ancestors did. Thank you.
So let's talk about before the quarantine happened, before you know, we began to experience this change in life. Your company was preparing for a performance at the South Dallas Culture Center, and it was Blues in the Jungle. Was that the piece?
Blues? It's a section of Blues for the Jungle.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. So those were the works that you were going to be working. Well, you had worked on, had been working on to fit.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. And how many people do you have in that was going to be performing in these pieces? Is it trio, duets?
That particular dance is a duet. Okay. Just a male and a female.
Okay.
And it's a slice that you go, ooh, about, you know, it's riveting. I don't think it's the last section. Well, I know it's not. There's a company in Taiwan, of all places, well, not of all places, but they're not African-American at all. But they saw the value. I think human beings have you know, some people don't believe in soul. Some people don't like to say spirit, but there's some trace in human existence that is common to all people. And even though they're in Taiwan, they recognized the value of Elio. And which takes me back to America, where, again, I was reading something, you know, especially since we're home, you know. They tell you about undervaluing. Undervaluing because of skin color. Undervaluing someone because of gender, and allowing crimes to just go ahead and kind of be put aside because they're not important to that value system. But we are learning through people like Elio and Dr. Primus and Catherine Dunham and others, Don McHale, they want us to do something. And I think, and I know I'm jumping back and forth, but there's something by Donald McHale, one of her esteemed ancestral choreographers, a whole piece, I don't know what the whole piece is called, but there's a solo for a woman. And I think you do it well.
Oh, me?
Now, yes, you. Now, wait. Oh, by the way, who are you? Who are you?
Who
are you? You are Michelle Gibson, the Michelle Gibson. Oh, let me jump around and around and around. First, I want to say I saw a performance where there were, I don't know, many guys. And they did a beautiful show. I liked it very much. It was a Saturday night in the Arts District in Dallas. And I thought, wow, that's amazing. And then on Sunday, I went to see a one-woman show. She held a stage. She could dance. She commanded. She drew you in. She reached you. So I was like, that's you. That's who that was. And I say that Donald McHale legacy said they would like to keep his works going because he died recently. Well, recently is relative, a few years ago.
Years ago.
I had worked with Donald before, but they want to keep his works alive. And they're saying to me, oh, you worked with Donald? You can do some of his works. And I'm like, well, we have a small company and a small budget. We do what we can, but.
So do you think that moving forward with your company, that you will always have space, like your company will be one of the companies that will continue to present works of Elio Palmieri for the preservation?
That's
a part of your company's
what
mission.
We want to do.
Right.
For one thing, you have to have roots. Mm-hmm. You have a trunk. You have new leaves. But you can't forget the roots. And there are the people who came before us who did important things that are important today, as important as they were then.
Are there other pieces that you are thinking about presenting, Mr. Pomare's pieces, in the future, and, you know, that you would like to present?
There are many. I don't think we have the forces to present that many, but there is a trio of women who had to do with the Haitian boat crisis, uh-huh. Rado, and that's something we could do. We could do smaller works. We're not big enough to do the big things. And at that time, it didn't matter. Let me phrase that differently. It wasn't important to get paid. It was a tighter knit community. So travel wasn't an issue, and people are more willing to do several jobs so they could do one in particular.
Are we talking about when you were in the company?
A little bit of both. Yeah, because one time I had like 5 dance jobs and I could pay the rent that month from just dancing. But that was like then. I had to do other things, you know, teach, worked at a ticket agency and so on. But there were a lot of people who had, he had a big group. He had a big group of people who worked with him. And I don't think we can produce that kind of work. Now in Taiwan, they have a large group and bigger funding, so they can. But for us, to answer the first question, that yes, I do want to keep that alive. I do want to keep that legacy alive. Because I think these were very important people that I was fortunate enough to work with. And we have to start small, but hopefully it'll, small isn't necessarily insignificant.
Right.
Small can sometimes glow.
Right.
You know.
Well, I'm wowed by your connection. Like, to be able to know someone and talk to someone that had one-on-one connections with a legend, a legend in Black dance.
Yeah.
In Black dance studies, cultural studies, you know.
I'm humbled by that experience.
It really is.
I'm like, really? Every now and then I think, wow, I was there then with that person in the room. Yeah. And it was, you know, when Elio was working on a solo for me, it was Elio and me alone. Not just a group. And it was just fine. You know, he had a reputation as being volatile. But when he was working with me, he wasn't. You know, he pushed me and I was like, okay, I'll try it, but I don't think that's possible. But I tried it and eventually I could.
Right. And you know what? At the end of the day, you know, if you look at a person's work, a choreographer's work, you see their character. You see their personality. You kind of see where their psyche kind of lives, right? And his work was very, what people would say, provocative.
Right.
And the way that, from what you know, the things that you've shared, the way that he instructs and the way that he works with dancers is very adamant. He's adamant. So he was that's passion. People take passion for violence, you know, but in his case, it was the passion of whatever he was, you know, he had his hands on or he was creating.
Right.
So moving forward, just, you know, before we kind of wrap up, tell me like where you see your company inside of his work. And also, how do you get, and this is very important, you have to answer this for me. Mm-hmm. Because you can't just do a choreographer's works without getting permission.
Right.
The rights. Mm-hmm. How is, who's the person, first of all?
Okay.
I don't know if you want to share that.
All right.
person that that you know is maintaining Mr. Pomare's works? Mm-hmm.
At the moment, well, not at the moment. It fell to Elio died without completing his book and without cataloging his work. Mm-hmm. You know, that's not what an artist is about, cataloging, unless you're a catalog or archivist person. So he didn't. And so his partner, Glenn, was doing that. And then Glenn died suddenly. And it was like, well, what do we do? Now, as it turned out, Marshall Romain was had danced with Elio. Mm-hmm. And it was left to Marshall to continue the legacy. And Marshall's now the person we go to for license. Permission. Right. Fortunately, Marshall knows of my time with Elio, and he knows Elio trusted me. And so Marshall trusts me. And I do my darndest to make sure it's just right. So the Marshall can say, okay, but he's the one in charge of the Pomare legacy right now.
But you know what, Lars? That is so honorable. It is honorable that you are trusted with this work. Mm-hmm. It's honorable that you had the opportunity to work with Mr. Pomare one-on-one. And it's honorable for us as an audience to be able to view, you know, the preservation of these works. So let me say thank you.
Yes, I am humbled, I'm grateful, I'm astounded by how lucky I was. I mean, the stars aligned in my favor.
Yes, I say.
We as elders, and I'm not trying to put you in that category yet,
No,
you're not there yet. Don't worry. It'll come.
You know what? I'm looking forward. I'm actually looking forward to it, but just why not?
Yeah. But we as elders are grateful that the work is being preserved. And I am glad that, you know, I can do a little part in it. You right. know, I can't do everything because I'm not Elio, and two, it's like too big, but I can do little things that say, watch this, mm-hmm. uh-huh. let's go further. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yes. Well, yeah. I mean, in order for things like this to happen, in order for mm-hmm. Companies to be able to do this, there's some support that has to happen. So I think, you know, we have a few people to thank for this moment, the City of Dallas Office of Arts and Culture for bringing these works of information to the community. We would also like to thank, of course, first and foremost, the South Dallas Culture Center that has been a home and a hub for Beckles Dance Company and also myself, Exhibit Dance Collective, and any collective, anything we've done, the South Dallas mm-hmm. Culture Center has been their root. So we thank you, South Dallas Culture Center. The Moody Fund for the Arts, the State Fair of Texas, the Salmon Center for the Arts, the Star System of Donors that support Beckles Dance Company, the Pomare Legacy, and Mr. David Fuller. We thank all of you.
Yes.